startup, but with a good amount of funding. We are doing some good stuff with VoIP, and our stack is right now about 90% JavaScript, about 10% PHP. I handle all the JavaScript parts there. I have a very good friend, Mehul here, who's a colleague there, who does everything else. I'm stuck at. So if you're stuck at anything, he's the guy you should say, I'm just presenting here. So you can find me on Twitter at that weird name. I have a blog which I haven't updated in ages, but you might find some good stuff there. So basically, can you guys connect to the internet? Can everybody connect to the internet? Okay. So what I've basically done is, you can find all the code that I'm going to show you here on that first URL. Right? It's a. How many of you are familiar with Git? So this is on GitHub. All the code is on GitHub. So what I've done is I've created like tags. So you'll have to check out each tag, and every step you'll have a new tag. So I'll tell you which tag to look at. Right. And the slide is currently running on GitHub as well. So it's like GitHub pages. Right? So you can find that there. Just for your information, if you want to use this later. Just a disclaimer, this is not what I have made. It's like an amalgamation of at least three things that I've plagiarized. So I don't say that I've created any of these. Okay. Cool. Okay.
Don't you also send the links to all the attendees?
Yes.
Yeah. Cool. So Node.js, cool. So what's the big deal with Node.js? So one of the major things, some of the cool things that it does is it's JavaScript. Everybody here is like here because of JavaScript, right? The big things thrown around that a lot of people say is it has non-blocking I/O, it's event-driven, it's fast and efficient. So you hear all these big terms and nobody actually tells you what they are and how they are related to JavaScript and stuff like that. So once you get the whole idea that how everything relates together, you'll have a better idea of why you should even consider Node. I mean, you're already familiar with so many server-side frameworks that why do you need to consider something new? It's not new, but still. Okay. So JavaScript, as the feature says, what if JavaScript was the only thing you needed? Right? You don't need like three different languages to run your stack. JavaScript on the front end, something on the back end, something for your SQLs, something else for your deployment. Currently, we are at a state where we can actually do everything in just JavaScript. Everything can be run in JavaScript. And my whole hope is that we move to a world where everything compiles down to JavaScript. So you still do C++, but when you hit compile, instead of creating an object file, will probably spit out some JavaScript and you can run it on a browser. Very cool. Okay. So, good things about JavaScript. A lot of people know JavaScript. It's one of those languages that people don't really learn. You have a C++ background or C# background, you look at the code and you're like, oh, I've seen this. This looks familiar. So everybody's familiar with it. But nobody knows about it, like nobody learns the language. Well, that's a good start. If you're familiar, you'll be able to get to know it well faster, right? So there's a low barrier to entry. You can get stuff working faster. So you have all done JavaScript, right? So in JavaScript, most of the stuff that you do for the browser is all event-based. So you have a button click, you say something dot click, and you have a handler that you wire up to it. You say, whenever somebody clicks the button, go run this code. Right? Whenever somebody does this, go run this code. So nothing is sort of flowing in one way. It's sort of a loop where everything is coming together. It's all event driven, and it's natively async. Everything happens async. You do an AJAX call, it's async. You don't tend to do a lot of synchronous activity in the browser, because the moment you do any synchronous stuff, your browser will block and your user will see that as his mouse not moving or his keyboard not working. That's bad. So everything is event based there, right? The last, but something that is really awesome to me is team redundancy. Imagine having your server side guy and your client side guy both working in JavaScript and understanding each other's code. So in bigger, like big teams, 20, 30 people, there are 10 people just doing front-end stuff. They have this small community of people who are just hacking away JavaScript. And you have this other 20 people who are doing this amazing server-side stuff. And they're doing C#, and probably both of them never talk. Right? So you could have your front-end and the back-end devs and anybody in between talking the same language. There's far more communication. And it's easier to get things done, right? And then you can do stuff like what I call myself, a full stack engineer. I do from like a client to the server to the database to deployment, sort of doing everything, right? So if you had everybody doing sort of everything, I guess you could go on leaves more often. Right? Cool. So it means that you can write all code in JavaScript, which is good for me. I'm a big fan of JavaScript, so it's a big thing for me. Right, so we get to the big first big word, non-blocking I/O. Right. So the biggest thing that when you write like a networking code, right, most of your networking code, or at least about like 75% of it, has to do with something in the I/O. Go get this data. Go get something from a file, go the internet, ping some server, get some data from it. So half of the time is spent just waiting for data. Your server isn't really doing stuff, it's just waiting for stuff. So what happens is, in like the traditional sense, you'd write code like this. You'd say apples equals db.query, get me some apples. And then you'd say response.send apples. If you were to look at this code, right, this is how we've all learned it. This is how we write code. We never think that when we come here, the process is going to stop and wait till that query completes and gets back data. You never think of that. You think of it as it just happens. But there's so much stuff that goes on when that is happening. And there are CPU cycles being wasted, just sitting there waiting for apples to come back. Wouldn't it be cool if you know that apples will come back sometime? In the meantime, I could do something else. Maybe do another request, and something else. Or just stay idle. I don't want my CPU to spin. It's really cool. So in the traditional sense, your server would look something like that. Right? So, since when you're blocking, you can't accept another request. So, if you were fetching apples and a second person comes to your server and says, okay, I want apples too, he can't get apples because you're already fetching some apples for somebody else. So, the easy way of, not the easy way, the way that everybody gets around this is you spawn a new thread. You have a complete new thread which can now accept a new request and hence do work. But you see these red things, right? So you have thread processing, which is okay. Right? It's doing some work. But you also have this thread in a waiting mode, which is what we were talking about. Getting apples, just waiting, sitting out to get the apples back. Right? So as soon as you have like a huge load, let's say 1,000 people come in, 10,000 people come in, right? So you have these 10,000 threads that are consuming memory, that are consuming all your CPU, and are doing nothing. You have 10,000, like you have like a super amazing server, and you have 10,000 threads, but they're not doing nothing. They're just waiting for data to come back. So you can't really truly do concurrent serves without so you can't do concurrent servers without having blocking. If you want to do it correctly, this is a way to do it, but the Node.js philosophy is that this is the wrong way to do it. The correct way would be to have like a framework which doesn't block, which is able to handle more requests, and somehow without blocking, it's doing all this stuff. So our server never stops. You still have threads, like you still have to get work done. But you would delegate that to, let's say, the OS. OS is doing loads of stuff, right? But the server doesn't have to wait. So that can only be done if the server itself is async and it supports this whole not waiting. There's no way you can wait. You'll always do stuff. So how does Node.js get around it? So IO in Node.js is basically async. We've all seen this before. Just think of it as an AJAX request. Everybody's done AJAX requests. So when you do an AJAX request, all you do is you say what AJAX you want to do, and you give it a callback, a success or a failure callback. And you tell it that whenever my server responds, go do this. So that's exactly what it's doing. It's saying db.query get apples. You have, so that's within that function. It's a parameter, an anonymous function being passed. So this is our callback. So basically, if you were to run this, the server would get here and then just drop through. This would be immediate. The query would be fired immediately and the code would end. You wouldn't have any sort of wait here. It would go, the server would be free to do stuff. There's no waiting happening. Cool, so this is how it would look. So to make all that happen, we need the other sort of big words that are thrown around. So one of them is evented. So the only way you can use callbacks is when you know when to use them. I've given you a callback, but if you don't know when should I use that callback, there's no use, right? So you need to have events. So an event is nothing but some interrupt coming in and telling that, hey, this has happened and do something about it. So Node.js has this big, huge event loop. It's a single threaded event loop, just like your browser JavaScript. So your browser JavaScript is also single threaded. It has an event loop. So what the event loop basically does is that it always takes, I'll do that a little later, but this it's sort of like a big overview. So if you look at this from the previous example, right, you had a lot of red there, and the red was bad because the red was waiting. If you come here, there is no red because you never wait. It's always doing something. So even if you had like 10,000 requests, it would accept 10,000 requests. It wouldn't mean that it's processed 10,000 requests, but it has the ability to accept 10,000 requests and then serve you back whenever you get the data. And in turn, accept more requests whenever that happens, right? You guys have any doubts or queries about this? Confusing, not confusing?
No ideas.
So,
you said like
you'll
be like non-looking
and you'll
accept 10,000 requests. But internally
you're
still processing it one by one, right?
So it's not processing it one by one. Imagine it having, so you saw the code, right? Imagine that for 10,000 queries. Right? So the first query comes in, it's like really minuscule, it just goes through. because that query, to fire the query, the server doesn't need a lot of resources. And it's free like that instant. So I'm not saying the response will come back, but at least the second person won't get a timeout. You won't get a 504.
Because the OS is still spawning threads. Right?
Yeah, the OS is
10,000 threads.
Yeah, it will still have 10,000 threads, but the OS is doing that. Yeah. Your server isn't doing that. So it won't happen that your server does like 10,000 stuff and then just dies. Or it can't accept anything more. So you're sort of pushing everything, and the OS is designed to do that.
Yeah.
Like it knows how to do it. It's not just your app doing it. It's got like a 10,000 other stuff that it's doing. So the whole idea is that your OS knows how to do this. It's built to do this. It knows how to context switch, right? This will get a little bit more clear when we get to like the code examples. I know what the.
So, what if the DB or the resource is configured in such a way that the DB cannot handle so many requests at a time, and it serves an interrupt saying that
That's another issue altogether. Like, so that's not my server's fault, right, in a sense. So what they would then do is that they would have like multiple servers. Obviously, you can't, if you were doing like MS SQL server, you'll have to scale up. You'd have to have like 100 GB of RAM and like a mega machine handling it. But you have stuff like, for example, you have MongoDB, which scales horizontally. So you can have like a server farm of Mongo instances running, and they'll be fine. Though. So that's scale. So that's different.
And even with a traditional database server,
scales
vertically, you can just stick a load balancer in front.
Huh. So you can still have like two medium-sized stuff. So that's scalability. That's like another level. That's everywhere. Like what you are saying will happen even in the threaded model. Like even in traditional stuff, you'll have to do extra stuff to scale. But what I'm trying to say here is that to get from 1 to 100, there is nothing. It's free here. But in the threaded model, it's not free. You have like some cost. You have to have like a good machine to handle it. But I can have a crappy old, like 5 years old laptop running 1,000 queries easily on Node. Right? Because it's not doing any work. Essentially, if you look at it, your server is just a proxy between your data and your app. It's not doing any computations as such. Unless you're doing some hyphen-loop math or whatever. But usually the stuff that we write at enterprise level, there's nothing involved. It's either on the client or on like some compute server which is doing the compute. The server itself is just proxying stuff here and there. So it needs to be like really fast to, you know, handle concurrency. So the web is getting like really real time. It was okay 5 years ago to say, take care, I'm getting like 5 people. But nowadays everybody wants Gmail, like Google speed, right? You click and everything will happen. So that delay shouldn't occur. So that's what we're trying to do. So it's what I was saying. It was designed to be highly concurrent. So scalable web apps and all that stuff, right? Really fast. So one of the reasons it's really fast is Node.js was built on top of V8. V8 is the JavaScript engine that Chrome uses. So it's built by Google. Really brainy people built it. They built something really good. So all that Node.js is basically some sugar on top of V8. So it's some libraries that can run on the super efficient VM on the server side. So it's not a new framework, it's not a new language, it's not doing what other people are doing. It's just sugar to get you to write code and run stuff faster.
So is V8 the fastest JavaScript engine that you have?
Right now they're benchmarking it as being the fastest.
Because like the newer Java version uses Nash
Engine,
so I don't know, like, how does V8 compare to Nash Engine?
I have
the Nash Engine that the new JDK is using.
Oh, that JDK, right? This is a Java expert engine.
Yeah, so it is compiling JavaScript.
Yeah, but I think so. That is a post Java to JavaScript.
It is JavaScript to Java.
JavaScript to Java. Okay.
Yeah, like GWT.
GWT. They threw away GWT because they couldn't handle it.
So I just want to know that how does that stack up? Because if like Java guys are going to use
right now on production, if you ask, right, if you're on anybody on Node, I mean, why Ryan Dahl went with, okay, you spoke about Ryan?
No.
Ryan is the guy who built Node.js, okay? He started this in 2008-9. Okay, so we had before zeroing on JavaScript, we tried Haskell, Lua, and all this. The problem that I stumped him was I/O. All the I/Os were actually blocking, which couldn't. And luck of luck, JavaScript never had any blocking I/O, even though it's like been there 10 years. So that's why he kind of plonked for using JavaScript out there. And the problem till, but that is plaguing JavaScript for 3 to 4 years of his initial, the JavaScript engine was bad. Okay, let's put it in the word. It's really bad. With this, the way Chrome engine, now that changed everything. This worked quite fast and like that. So you see, whatever Joel is saying is absolutely right. I mean, now at this, the V8 is the de facto standard that you're going to use. So if you're going to go in production, it's V8. So even what you're saying about it is not right production really. I don't know how much people are using that, whatever it
is. So the thing is, V8 does spend a fair amount of time on compilation. But once stuff is compiled, it runs at almost native speed.
Yeah.
So it's really fast.
See the guys, they're not working on that. The Casper, the guy, performance engineer for V8 engine.
Okay.
So whatever mistake Mata Puri with it, JavaScript now it's required.
No, because this is like a future, because I keep telling people that JavaScript is really cool, because so Java, as you said, had this dream that write once, compile it. Write once, run everywhere. Right? They're still struggling. Really, really struggling to do this. But if you think about it, JavaScript did it from day one. Right? You write JavaScript once, you can run on any damn browser. Yeah. But that's a DOM. That's not a JavaScript problem, right? So that's sort of true. Right now it's even more true because now you can run JavaScript out of a browser. So you have Node, which runs on almost all platforms, and all you need to do is write JavaScript, and you can run it everywhere you need.
So what is Node role in this at all? Is it just a
sugar? It's just a sugar. So people can't work with V8, right?
Okay, so
you can't just directly work.
It's like an API on top of it.
So think of it as being like the Cadillac. V8 is just the engine. You have like a super awesome engine, but you still need seat and wheels and steering wheel and brake and.
What Node provides an API on top of V8.
Yeah. So it provides an API on top of V8 to access V8, plus like really good libraries. So because it's networking, they do all the low-level stuff really well. So you have things like HTTP, crypto, TCP, WebSockets. All the low-level networking stuff is all done. You don't have to do it again. But it also means that it's very low-level. It's not like, so somebody coming from ASP.NET, for example, will be like, whoa, why do I have to write a server? I just need to write my code and put it on IIS. So here, you don't have IIS. Node itself runs as a server, which is like a really powerful concept. Right? Once you think about it, you don't have deployment. Right? You don't have to like pack your files and put it on IIS or put it on Apache or Nginx. Right? Node itself is the server. It's, your code is like tightly integrated into the server itself. So instead of having one big ass server and putting all the stuff, all the apps on it, you have tiny little servers with its own sort of, so it's more distributed and it's, you can think about stuff really fast because of it. I think I'm taking too much time. So it's really efficient because it's not blocking at all. It's doing things fast. It's asynchronous and event driven, as it said. So the biggest challenge people have coming to Node.js, if you're not a JavaScript developer, is to think about async, because everybody else is just stuck in the synchronous world, right? You're stuck to the whole idea that my I/O will come back and I will use it when I want it. The moment you go async, you have to like think about it really weirdly, because your flow of code is not linear anymore. It's like this whole big hole that you go into. It's, they call it callback hell. It's really hell. But there are like code patterns that you can use to get out of it. But, so a very fast introduction to what this whole event loop thing is. So think of it as you have Node app which you're writing, right? The V8 engine, right? So every time you write a Node app, it has access to the V8 engine, right? You write a function, it has a callback, right? So all the code that you write sits in sort of like a queue. So the queue has one whole run of code, right? So if you go back to our earlier examples, db.query, get apples, and then a callback. In the first go, it would only execute db.query. That's it. Right, that's the one go that it can do. So it's that one loop. Right? After the one loop, it's free. It doesn't have to do anything. Till the time somebody else comes and says, okay, I have your apples. Right? So that loop is, once the loop completes and Node doesn't have anything else to do, it doesn't do anything. It just sits there. So it's not sleeping. Usually you have this term where you say, do something, sleep, and then do something else for having a wake. But that sleep is more expensive because you have one thread that can potentially do stuff, but it is not doing anything because it's sleep. But in JavaScript, that's not the case. It's like a continuous, it's good to go. Like, it's always in this mode where it's saying that, okay, give me something to do. Right? So if another thing comes in, it'll just take that up and do. If there is another db.query get apples, it will instantly do it and come back and say, okay, I'm done with it. And whenever our apple comes back, it knows what to do because it has a callback for it.
So the event loop is essentially just a monitor on the queue.
Yeah. So, it's really simplistic to think about it because it's going around and around, and there is a queue. It's just picking stuff out of the queue, doing it, coming back, seeing if there is anything on the queue, doing it, coming back. Nothing on the queue, do nothing. Right? So, that's sort of what it's saying, that, you know, you can have three different tasks that run three different times, but they all run sort of without any hindrance to each other.
Can we have a sort of thing where the inner callback, in the scenario of a callback hell sort of thing, that you have a callback which
involves
the resource which again has a callback, that sort of, can we execute those two asynchronously, like the topmost
Because it's single threaded, it's essentially single threaded, you can never have anything in parallel. Right? So you will never have, so you won't have problems either. So in concurrent systems, there is this big problem where you have parallel stuff running, right? So the trouble with running parallel stuff is that you almost always have shared state. Right? So you don't know if the first thread should access that or the second thread should access that. And loads of stuff to think about when you're doing that. In this model, it's only one single thread. You are almost always, it's not always, it's 100% guaranteed that you're only doing one thing at a time. But it's doing that one thing really fast. So you can do 10 things really fast instead of like doing 10 things parallel. So it may seem parallel, but in JavaScript, nothing is ever parallel. It's always, always single. So yeah, that's loads of talk. Let's get down to some code. Right. Okay, cool. Okay. Thank you. Okay, cool. So the way I have structured this is I have like a set of examples, and if you do have access to the internet, I really hope you can use that. You can go to that. You can go there. You can clone that repo. Okay. So if you don't know Git, it's okay. You can still go to that repo. So you can go to that repo. For people who have Git, can clone it, or you can always go to releases. And basically just download the zip. Right, so that's step one, step two.
Just clone the whole repo.
Yeah, just clone the whole repo. So I'll just mirror my set. It's easier for me to do here. So basically, once you've cloned it, you can get to the first example, which is saying git checkout dash f force step dash 0. Okay. Cool. And So if you have Node installed on your machine right now, Node has a REPL. You guys know what a REPL is? So it's REPL is read evaluate print loop. Right? So basically, it's like going to the browser's console. You've used DevTools, right? So you go to the console, and what you see on the console is basically a REPL. You can type in JavaScript and it will give you answers. Right? So basically you can say node and it drops you to a REPL. Right? So the weird, okay, guys can't see it. But basically it's like a prompt that comes and you can do stuff. So you can do normal JavaScript here. So you can do 1+1 and I can't see it. So you can basically run JavaScript here, right? So you can do any sort of stuff. So you can have function add comma b. So that you can define it there, and I can just say have full autocomplete. says add as a function. It gives me 3. So that's Node in like the shortest possible thing that you can say. It's just an execution engine where you can write JavaScript and print out stuff. But it's also a lot more. It's got internal libraries that you can use, right? So one of the internal things that it's right now seeing, so for example, in the browser, if you were to go to the browser, do an F12, you're in the console, right? And you can, you always have this window, right? It's like a global object, right? It'll give you tons of stuff. And that's where everything resides, in a sense, all your stuff. So you can think of Node having that as well. It's called process in Node. So you can do process, and it just spits out like tons of stuff that you can use. Okay. So it basically has like what version of Node you're running, what are the native modules that it's loaded. It has all your environment variables, so you can do stuff like process.env, and it'll print out all your environment variables. In Windows, it'll give you all your path variables, I think. Not too sure. So that's the REPL. So why is this important? Is because when you're working with Node, it's just like working with the browser, right? Many times when I'm working with JavaScript code, I'll just put it into the browser's console to see if everything is working. It's like, you can use that here as well, right? So you can quit out, right? Okay, that was the process. And since it's customary to have a hello world in all programming courses, this is Node's version of hello world. So it's just console.log hello world. Another thing to sort of notice here is that they have tried their level best to keep all the terminologies that JavaScript developers are already know. So they didn't have to call it console.log. They could have called it print. Would have worked as well. So you have to understand that console.log is not a JavaScript thing. That's not the language feature. Right? It's a function that some library provides. So console.log here, Node is providing you that library. Right? So this is simplistic enough if you were to run this. So the way you run stuff in Node is you say, so if you've done Python, you'll do something of this sort where you say Node, if it's index. And all it does is it just says hello world. Because that's what it told you to do. Right? Also, the process quits. It doesn't wait. It's done its job, so it just quits. There is no, it's not running behind, sort of waiting for something to happen. It's done its stuff and it's out. Right? Okay, let's go keep going. Okay, so this now is a little more complex, right? If you're familiar with JavaScript, you will also know set timeout, right? So anybody care to say what this will print out? It's set timeout. Set timeout only does one. So it's basically saying, say hello, and then after 1500 milliseconds or 1.5 seconds, say world. But something to internalize is that this code runs fast, right? It'll do set timeout, and set timeout is past the callback. right? And it's told to wait that time. And obviously console.log is immediate, right? So you can think of it as the first loop only does set timeout, and that's it. And goes and keeps a pointer somewhere that, okay, after 1500 milliseconds, give me an interrupt. And it just says, hello world. And then Node just does whatever. Its own thing, right? Doesn't have to do anything till that 1500 seconds. So we'll just run this and see how that looks. So say same stuff, node index.js. You see hello and then later. So it says hello and sometime later it says world, right? I don't know why it's cutting out that screen. Okay, cool. So even this time, it did wait for a little bit of time and then it quit, right? Okay. So this, I've changed something smaller again. It's doing a set interval. Any guesses to what this will do? Obviously, you already said it, but if I were to run this. Okay. It will basically keep doing that.
So, where are these global functions coming from?
The global functions are part of Node. It's like there. It's little. It's not part of process, but it's.
Sorry. Oh,
what did
this invert your colors?
Or your
colors?
I don't know.
I don't know. Preferences, profile preferences. It's there, it's in general.
Okay.
Yeah, that's it. You were just hovering on monospace 9.
Okay. That good? Okay, cool. So in the meantime that we were doing all that, it's still working on its stuff. So there is like a massive difference between the previous step and this step. And that sort of tells you how Node is working. The previous step, the program actually quit. This step, it's not quitting. Right? Because every time it executes that one loop, there's something else in the queue. Every time set timeout is hit, it's putting something into the queue, right? So the next event loop, it already has something to do, although it's 1500 milliseconds later. So that queue never ends, which means that Node will go on forever. Right? But it still doesn't mean that it's blocking. I could still have something going on in between those 1500 milliseconds. Yeah? See. So you saw me do control C all the time. Whenever it was going on and I had to do control C to get out of it. So one of the things that people almost always get stuck on is you do all this stuff and then it's doing things and you want to sort of gracefully end stuff. Right? You don't want somebody doing a control C and then just your server messing up something else. Right? So this is more Unix kind of thing. Basically, the process variable. So the process variable that we saw, the bigger document variable that I told you about.
You can keep the lights for me.
Yeah.
Just turn on the light.
So what this is basically saying is that whenever it gets second, which is a control C, do something. It's basically handling input from the user and doing something about it. In this case, I'm just printing something out to the console and just exiting. But you could think of it as whenever something like this happens, you could clear up stuff, like give your program enough time to maybe close database connections, clean up some memory, do some cleanup stuff before you exit. So this time if you're on Node.js, still doing hello world, hello world, hello world. This time when I do control C, it'll print that and then die. Cool. So that was kind of the hello world of simplicity, right? You want to do something more practical, right? One of the things you might want to do is read a file. Everybody has files and you want your server to read a file when somebody makes a request, right? So we come to one of these things you'll always see, which is the require keyword. Right? So it's like in other libraries as well, when you want to bring in code that is not part of your app right now, you use a require. So require is actually from a standard they call CommonJS. So it uses CommonJS's require to do stuff. So in this case, we are using FS, which is an inbuilt module, which is a file system module. All you're doing is you're requiring FS, which brings in FS to your app, and then you can do require FS.read file. And in our whole callback fashion, it's always async. It doesn't block. Even while reading files, it'll send that command out, and after it has read everything, come back with the data you want, and you just log it out. Right? So this is quite simple. What I've done is I have this small file, data.json, has a simple text in it. So we can write again. So all it does is it gets the text from the file and just prints it out. But it's still async. It's not blocking for that call. Okay, cool. So we've been talking about servers till this time, but I've never shown you any code. So this is a very simplistic web server. Right? This is a complete web server, can handle requests, can give you a response, everything. And it's like 12 lines of code. So it's, again, getting in a native module. So HTTP is a native module, which comes with Node. Right? So what you can do is you can use a create server to create a server. And the create server takes a callback. So what create server internally does is it does all the magic to bring up a server which is listening on a TCP socket and can accept requests, right? But all you need to think about is what you want to do with the request. You're not sort of thinking about how the connection is being made. That's being encapsulated from you. So all you have to do is that once you get the request, it gives you these two objects. One is a request object, incoming request, and the outgoing response. Right? So on the response, you can obviously write out to the response. It'll be something that you want to send back to your user. So I'm writing back a 200, and I'm saying, so it's a write head, so it's writing a header. I'm writing the header of content type, it's text plain, and all it does is write hello world after that and just ends. You can also see that I have something after that which is listen 3000. So I'm basically telling it that create the server. Right? If I were to just create the server, it wouldn't do anything. It would just create the server and exit. It's kind of pointless to have a server that's created and just that's it. You have to tell it to listen on some port. So I'm giving it 3000 and so it does, right? Let's just see if it works. So you can see that the server is running on port 3000. Right? So how do we sort of... So I can bring up another terminal. And we'll call it. It says hello world to me. So I don't know why my hopefully if you guys were to ping this IP, you would get a hello world as well. If you guys
were. Ping the port number.
Yeah. So you can do, if you're on Unix, you can do curl 172.16.145.103:3000 and you'll get the response too. Or you can just open a browser, put that thing in, so you can do you can go here. And still give me hello. Right. So you can do that on a browser as well. Guys, trying it. I'll just okay. Cool. Okay. Cool. So now I'm sort of coming to the place where we can kind of see, kind of prove in code that it is doing async stuff. It can handle more than one request at a time. So what I've done here is the same code as before. The only difference being that it'll take 2 seconds to process your request. Right. So if you can see, it says hello world, and then there is a set timeout. So effectively think of the set timeout as being an I/O call. Right. So let's say I increase the timeout to 5 seconds. Right? So if I increase the timeout to 5 seconds, it'll take 5 seconds for it to write world and then close the connection. Right? So it doesn't close the connection till you say response.end. Right? To do that. Right. So I have the server running. Local. Saying hello. And wait 5 seconds. Does world and comes back. Right. So if you were to think about it, this is not usually possible in HTTP. So I come from ASP.NET, right? In ASP.NET, I couldn't do this. Because what ASP.NET does is buffering, right? So if you have, let's say, 10 things to do, right? Then you're waiting like 1 second each to do that thing. The server actually buffers the whole content and then sends back everything, right? So your client would sort of get, okay, I got your request, and then it'll wait whatever time, 10 seconds, and then in one whole chunk, we'll get back the response, right? But if you were to see here, you got hello immediately. You didn't wait for anything to happen. Obviously, world was 5 seconds later, right? So how is that, how is it doing that? One of the things is it's setting these headers behind the scenes, and it's using something called streaming. I don't really understand exactly what streaming is, but think of it as a stream pouring water out. You're not waiting for the water to collect somewhere and then giving it to you. You can keep sending stuff to your client while you're processing data, which is insanely awesome if you think about it, because if you were to do something like video streaming, you can't have the client wait till the whole video is buffered on the client and then send it out. Right? It's more easier to send him chunks, have him play the chunks while more chunks are being downloaded. That's how you have YouTube, right? That's the way YouTube. I'm not saying it can't be done in the other things, but it's inbuilt, or that's the way Node does things. It doesn't know how to buffer things at all. There is no way you can buffer things in Node. Obviously, you can write code to make it do stuff, but by default, everything happens as a stream. Everything is streaming to you. So to see what it's doing, one of the things is if you do an I. Oops, sorry. So if you see the first part we set, the 200 we set, the text plane we set, date obviously the server setting. There are two things called connection and transfer encoding. Right? So the connection keep alive tells the client that I'm not done with it. Keep me alive till I tell you that things are dead. Usually what happens if you don't give that is that as soon as there is an end or there is a break in your data coming back from the server, the client will close the TCP connection, because that's how HTTP works, right? So you have to send it, keep alive to say that, okay, I'm not done doing it. Expect more stuff from me. And the other part, it's not done just with keep alive. You have this transfer encoding, which is chunks, which sort of tells the server that expect the data coming back to be in chunks. Right? There can be breaks. Don't worry about it. Just so the client can keep, but do whatever with it. The client can probably buffer it, or the client can start using it as soon as it's getting stuff. Right. Another thing that this allows us to do is So I have two terminals open, I have two curls, right? And what I can now do is think of the whole async blabber that I've been doing till now, right? If I were to hit my server with one curl, right, it would start processing that part. Right? It's single threaded. It cannot do two things at the same time. So if I were to send it, and we know that there's like 5 seconds wait between the time when things will complete. Right? So if I were to send something between that period, if all my async stuff works, I should get the hello in the other window as well. Right? That sort of tells us that, you know, Node is free enough to get another request. Hopefully this works. Cool. So it handled two requests. It's single threaded, right? So you can kind of make sense of it. It's doing things really fast and it's doing async. Because Node could do it because after doing the first hello, it's idle. It's not doing it.
Password log the request IP. I mean,
request IP.
Yeah,
okay.
We can like go and see stuff.
You want to see who is connecting to it? Ah, okay.
So after that, hello, probably you can print my server request.
Okay. So let's see this. I think it's it. I think it was request.agent. We'll see if things work. Right, so I'm not printing the remote address because I don't know the exact. I can Google it, right?
So why are you not using the response.write and then logging it?
So I'm not sending it to the client.
Okay.
So if you do response.write, it's actually sending it to the client. You know, so the console.log will happen on the server. So you'll see it in the server's terminal, right? Okay, that's request.agent, right? Too many stuff open. So if, okay, so somebody's hitting it, but I've not put the correct
property
out. So just give me a second.
Remote address.
Huh?
Remote address.
Remote address, okay. Correct?
Yep.
Okay, this is a good time to show you guys how to debug stuff then.
Doesn't Sublime have a Node language thing?
Sort of. It has a JavaScript.
It has JavaScript, but somebody has to write for Node.
I mean,
JavaScript is a language, so we didn't think all about whether the JavaScript, you know, like var and all that, previously the IDE language. Node.js is specific.
Like, okay, require, request. Not a language
stuff, right?
It's
slow.
Pardon me?
Connection.
Request.connection.meters.
Yes.
Okay. So basically, all of you guys who are hitting the server are going to get everything back only in 5 seconds, after 5 seconds, right? The thing completes in 5 seconds. But it's able to serve everybody, even with that one single thread, because it's not waiting. It's doing that first hello so insanely fast that it can actually do more than, I'm not too sure how many it can do, but let's say about 100 without.
Well,
it
depends on
your
event loop.
Yeah, it depends on my machine, but you can see the power like at this level, right? Okay, cool. So that was for this.
Yeah, I just tried it and basically Python ran out of threads before Node stops or anything.
Yeah, okay. Oh, I could do this. So I can run a benchmark. I think AB is installed. So I have a server running here.
Also, probably if you start in dev mode, so reboot like. Starting the server in dev.
I'm manually starting it, so it's okay. So I can do. So AB is like a benchmarking tool for Apache. So you can do, I think it was N100, C100. So basically what this will do is it will make 100 requests at a concurrency of 100%. So basically it's doing 100 requests at the same time. Hopefully this doesn't crash machine. Cool. So if you look at the, if it were blocking and if it were doing synchronous stuff, what you would have expected is it would have taken, so it's a wait of 2 seconds, right? So it would have taken 200 seconds to finish those 100 concurrent requests, right? But we are saying that it's async. It shouldn't take that much. All your requests should only take 2 seconds because it's doing them one after the other and then managing everything. So it basically took, so it says blah, 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 time taken for tests, 2.033 seconds. So if you think about it, the only overhead that was there, that was the actual processing that it took, was a 0.33 seconds. So it did 100 requests in 0.33 seconds. And the 2 seconds is obviously the weight that we put into the, and you can see that it completed 100 requests, nothing failed, no write errors. Yeah, cool. So that's that sort of shows you how concurrent you can get with Node. Okay, cool. Now that we have sort of seen that part, one of the things you should understand is, obviously I can't keep writing the whole, my whole server in one file, right? I would need some sort of a way to modularize my code, maybe share it with people, or just to keep sanity in my own project, right? So the require that you see, the require HTTP, you can do that for your own module. So you can write your own modules as well. You can write stuff that you are using as modules so that you can keep it in like separate files and then use it for like share it or whatever, or just keep sanity. So the way you write it, so here you can see that what I've done is I've refactored the same code. It's exactly the same. There was a listen 3000, right? The port number was sort of hard-coded there, right? So what we've done is I've made a small file, right? I've initialized a variable. It's an object which has port as a property and 3000 as its value, right? It's a variable and that's it. It's really simple, right? So the way you tell Node that you want to use another file. So if you think about it, JavaScript has this problem of global scopes, right? You can really easily pollute your scope with any damn thing you want, right? So when you're writing really complex code, you need like a very tight way of controlling what is given out from this module that you are doing. Because at the end of the day, all it is a JavaScript file and a bunch of JavaScript that's getting executed, right? So there is no way you can control stuff, right? So they came up with this really nice way of doing it where you define your code, right? And then you have this special syntax, if you will. There's this object called module and it has a property called exports. What basically exports is an object that will be exported when you do a require.
So is it alloc or is it in advance?
So whenever you require it,
exactly.
Whenever that require statement is hit, it will load in the file. It will load in this JavaScript file.
Yeah, trying to understand. Let's say if I wrap it inside the function, the way we do it in traditional JavaScript.
You can do that as well.
And then return object considering the things only you wanted at time.
But nothing will happen if you don't use the module.exports.
Exactly. So will config be still put up somewhere?
No, it won't be. So the basic idea that they have is that you can write whatever you want in the module. but only the things that you save need to be exported will be given back to the require call.
Rather like expose. So when you saw first the beavers, when you said require, this is
so it's not this line, it's that line.
That is pulling it. Okay, you know, expose, now I'm only, okay, whatever you expose, bring it here. So what a require part of common JS? Okay, and that's where you talk about global namespace pollution and all that happened because of that. So one way Ryan and all these guys have said, okay, we know this is a problem with JavaScript. So they built a common JS where this is mitigated. So you have your namespace, whatever garbage happens in that namespace, it doesn't.
Is this sort of processed once in the
history? Yeah, so if you, one good thing that you can say, okay, what happens is, suppose I call a require on this thing, and I call it twice or thrice, later on, how many times will this get initialized?
Okay, only once.
Only once. If you put an output statement and say require, there's only once it will be always required. So it does that initially. And that also has to do because with JavaScript, which differs very significantly with Java, is, you know, you try to declare a variable as late as possible in Java. Right? There's a good programming practice in Java at least. In JavaScript, it makes no sense because we always put all initialize at the start.
Yeah, if you don't, it will
always be
and the nesting works like this file.
Yeah. So you can have nested requires. So I can require stuff from here, go there, say, load the stuff. There's also
you have to be careful when you're loading things. I mean, if you've done JavaScript development, you have to make sure your scripts are ordered.
Yeah.
So if you say yes, and you're ordering load, then you get the undefined which you got.
Yeah.
So at the end of this, once you run through this, and whatever has to be exported has already been exported,
yeah,
is the rest of it just garbage collected, or does it sort of hang around in memory?
So the config will hang around in memory.
Yeah, but the rest of it
will be. But in a sense, if you're exporting something, I'm thinking that you might have references to all those stuff as well. Like whatever you're writing.
No, basically the variables. So if you have some complex processing in your module definition, and you are just exporting part of it, right?
So
you'll have internal variables. You'll have
either export an object or you'll export a function or whatever.
But the rest of the stuff, does that just get garbage collected at the end? After the
that is actually dependent on V8, right? I mean, now you have V8 doing
it. That's what I was trying to say as well. So let's say you have this whole... I can actually go to the other part. So you guys are okay with this, right? This is quite simplistic. It'll just give you back, if you look at index.json, what it's doing is it'll give you back the config variable, which has this config. Right, which is this, which is basically config.port equals 3000. Right. And then you can just directly use it as config.port. Right. What I have also done is, remember there was this whole function inside the create server, which is where you were handling all the requests. Right. So what I've done is I've taken that, refactored out that and put it into a its own file called a handler. Right? Even this, it's not really clear, but basically you can think of it as in my next thing, or maybe I'll just show you the next thing. So it's basically the same thing, the same function. Instead of now being like this huge blob in index.js, it's its own thing. It's one small thing that you can think about. The more code you have, the more confused you get. Use a file, there's no reference for you.
Can't you have an array of, say, all the requires, like you have in require.js? Require.js,
I think there is a...
gives you that, right? That, an array of all the requirements. Or defined.
Yeah, but that's different mode common.js, you're right on that. So mode of the same modernizing and packaging in the JavaScript. But this doesn't. That's a different. So there's the advantage of that, the advantages of this too. So, where require has is, okay, I'll get all of that, and only lazy loadings actually. You know, I'll load those, whatever arrays, just for them getting called at that.
So, but it's not like require.js, where you use require only when something has to be, like, eagerly.
Yeah, lazy loadings. I'll just call it when, you know, I want that thing done. No, I don't get the whole stuff. But if you look at in web development or whatever, how you happen, you know, the HTTP maximum 8 concurrent, you only send only JS, ek shot me cause. Minimize karo, concat karo, uglify karo, or page down.
I'm getting to like a big, huge chunk of this. Yeah. So what you can see here is that I've sort of increased what the handler can do now. It's doing tons of stuff, right? And you see down that it's just exporting handler. I've written tons of stuff here. Handler is only this much. And then all this stuff is not being exported. So once you call config handler, even though the file contained all these other functions, you had a route function, you had a serve static, you have parse CSV, and God knows how many other functions, I won't get all those functions outside. There's no way I can call anything that I've written there unless I've exported it explicitly. Right? Going back to Chinmay's question, will all the other stuff that I can't have access to, is it garbage collected? Depends. Because if you see, the handler is calling route. And route is calling parse CSV and static serve. So it does need to keep a reference to all that. Because whenever handler is called, it would need access to all that. So it'll still be in memory, but you just don't have access to it. But let's say if I were to write something here that I don't use anywhere. Obviously, you wouldn't do that. Why would you want a...
You might have a few local variables.
In a sense that maybe you use some function to initialize. Mm-hmm. Then you don't need it at all. Then that's a different case altogether. Right? So this was supposed to be actually a thing that you guys can do. If you go to step 9, right, you have like all the things you need for a proper web server. Right? You have request response, you know how to read a file, read a file, send it back. Right? So my idea was that if you guys want, you can have a go at downloading step 9, right? And adding to the handler two things. Right? One thing could be a static file server. So what a static file server is you say localhost :3000 / some file name, and that file exists on your server, it'll just serve that file straight to you. Right? So remember in one of the previous steps I'd shown you how to read a file, get the data. Right? Similarly, you can read a file, get the data, write it to the response. Do you guys want to have a go at doing that, or do you just want me to continue? We're all still in that concurrent thing. So there's supposed to be a workshop. So the idea was that I show you stuff. So the usual stuff is that I keep showing you stuff, You keep hearing it and then you get bored. So if you want to get like your hands dirty with code, you can try it out if you want. Otherwise, I'll just...
So I'll say just do it. I mean, it's just 2 minutes, I think, so not more than that. So you get to know where it is.
Right, so you can download step 9 because step 10 has the answers.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Okay, so you said require some file, some module that you had, right? Huh. On your, let's say on index.js, okay? And let's say that required file, let's say you require it at some other file as well. So let's say you have index.js and you have another module. This other module also requires that, let's say, module or whatever, yeah. Right? So is that module loaded twice in both files if you're using it? Or
no, only once.
No, it's all loaded only once. So it requires sort of acts like a singleton, if you can think of a singleton.
Okay, what I'm asking is, let's say you want to access your DB, right? You want to access it in multiple files, so you have to require that if you're using a module, say all your database operations, so you might require it in two files. So is it loaded twice when that is used? Or
so that's the reason. So if you told what I said, right? In Java, you just declare available as last as possible, and JavaScript makes no sense. You better do it as start. So when he's all calling out, it all maps it out. And he sees, okay, there's a double call happening. There's only one call that will actually happen. That's why when I said, if I put another require, if you put two requires to the same stuff, and they were like a console logout, you only see one console ever click on you. Okay?
So that means you can basically have your database process as a single terminal.
This is all this. And you want to prefer it to do that.
So you can basically have one session that's global to the entire app.
So you can also have instances in a sense, because you could declare your module as a class. I mean, JavaScript doesn't have a class, but you could do a new on that function, and you will get an instance.
It has classes. It has prototypal classes.
Hard. Okay. When you see classes, everybody is thinking of
so
classes.
What is the model singleton behavior? For example, our handler is sort of trying to get a file, say, a JSON file or some sort of AJAX call. And we wanted that AJAX data. It might be like sort of the response might change over time. So we don't want that module.exe.
So make another say, it looks by a variable, right?
Right.
If that variable is a different variable. Suppose it's Chinmay now, and that's his, and that's the DB connection. But there's another one that's making another variable. The OS or the compiler V8 doesn't know what is actually DB or not DB. It only sees the variable and then makes a call. So you can define it. So that time doesn't work as well.
Right.
But it's not a good practice. Okay, to do that.
Okay, maybe not as complex as I said. I'll go through you with you guys for doing like a simple thing. Let's say I wanted a logger, right? I want to, so instead of doing a console.log, every time I do a console.log, I want, let's say a date time stamp with that, right? And if I wanted to put that as a module, how would you do it? So let's say I create. If I have, okay, I call it logger.
Okay. So basically a log function.
Yeah, it's a log function with some extra.
Just console.log plus.
Yeah.
Your.
So say logger. Spelling is correct, right? Date time dot now. Don't like it. Do that. So it's basically a simple function which has a property or a method called info, and all it does is prints out the date time. I'm kind of okay. I can just say no date. Cool. So, So Sublime has this whole REPL, Node REPL inside it, so I was sort of testing out if my code works. So now this is basically my module. So how do you think I should export it? I need to use this in my other file. So what would I do?
Why is it still complaining?
It is. Okay. So we could then do our. Okay. Require. Right, so this should give us timestamp information. Okay, people still hitting it. Add like a console log, dot log somewhere.
So can we override console.log?
You can, JavaScript. It's JavaScript. That's one of the things you can do in JavaScript. Right? You can override everything, intentionally or accidentally.
Yeah, we give you a long log, so you can
save yourself. Awesome. Cool. So we've covered sort of how you can modularize your code. Write your own modules. It's really powerful when you do so. When you actually start writing code in Node, it's helpful to know all these things, because when I wrote my code first in Node, I didn't read about stuff like this. So you would have like horrendous code, which Mehul knows about. Right? So I have like this one file, which is 5,000 lines and has all the routes and all the handlers, everything in a single file. Right? It's only afterwards that I realize, oh, okay. You can do that.
Lucifer uses this all. Lucifer
uses all. Yeah, does.
You know,
he's
writing the code.
So yeah, cool. So that's modularization. Another thing is that you can. It's got a large community. Like Node has tons of people writing good stuff for it. It's like C++. If you were a C++ programmer, you would have tons of libraries to use with C++. And C++ itself isn't powerful. It's powerful because there's like a huge community supporting it. And the Node community as well is these really enthusiastic, really opinionated people who write good stuff. Right? So one way to get... I'll close this. So one way to get to know about new things, new Node modules, is they have a package manager, which is called npm, so Node Package Manager. So it's npm.org. No? Okay. Sorry, my bad. njs.org. I had no idea what that was. Yeah. Sorry about that. So this is maintained by the community. It's got like 93,000 packages now. So basically, if you think you need some sort of functionality, check here. Somebody must have already written it for you. Just include their stuff. Do whatever. Right?
So yeah, the guy's coming from Ruby. This is gems. Okay.
That's or one pip for the
package. Yeah.
So it's just a package manager. It's like apt-get for Ubuntu. Yes. TVing system.
So, but any idea of how much, what kind of numerical and scientific libraries support is available for Node?
Not really. I don't know. So one thing I would say off the bat is that maybe Node isn't a good place to do scientific stuff because it's very compute intensive, and Node is not built to be compute intensive. It's more of an IO thing. Like if you're doing something really IO intensive, do Node.
You want to check out that?
Yeah, it's JavaScript. Unfortunately, JavaScript only has floats.
Numbers.
Yeah, it's only floats.
Yeah.
You don't have an integer. So you can't really do math correctly. Nothing compute. So that's one pitfall. Node can't do, I wouldn't say Node can't do, but it's really hard to do.
Yeah, don't do like complex mathematics, you're going to go, then you'll have any problems. These are guys doing in JS, JavaScript, graphics or games, when they depend on that calculation happening, then it's.
So that's a good thing about, so one of the things is that don't stick to one thing. Node is not the magic bullet. Can't cure everything. It does what it does. It does like a very limited stuff, but it does it well. And if that is what you want to achieve, then yeah, go ahead with Node. But if, as he said, he's interested in more mathematical stuff. I'm saying that Node is the new shininess and I'll use Node to do math. May not be the correct way to go. There might be other things that do really well, but so
in terms of compute, the fact that V8 is compiling everything down should actually help a lot, right? With performance.
Performance is an issue.
The support is an issue.
Not even support.
Once you reach that edge penetration, you have 1 million. $0 There is a problem, right?
So it might not be built correctly. Okay, cool. So the reason I'm showing you this is because then you have this whole possibility that you don't really have to do all this stuff that I did, right? Just to write a small server that sends back stuff. So just to write a small server that is sending back three things, right? I have to write insane amounts of code, and that's like a bad thing, right? But that's the whole beauty of Node. It's really low level, but the stuff it does internally, it does it really well. So you can build on it. So people have already built frameworks, right? So one of the frameworks that a lot of people use is Express. Express is a web framework. It gives you, you can think of it like ASP.NET MVC. I keep seeing Microsoft because I was a Microsoft guy. That's the world I come from. So it's like ASP.NET MVC. You do stuff and it renders from, it renders templates and sends out views, has routing, has like the basics of building a web app really fast. But still, Express is quite bare bones. It's not like a do-all of stuff, but you can get started doing. So you don't have to do low-level stuff. Like you don't have to do routes like I'm doing, right? So if you were to, I didn't show you this part of code, but basically the way you would do routes without any framework would be request has a URL property. You would have to parse the URL to see which route you're going to, do like a switch case in my case. Do some function call based on what is being called, send back the data, sort of that stuff. Right? So that's tedious. You wouldn't want to do that. So what you would do is you would get a library that is doing most of the stuff for you, and then just think about the app that you want to write. And that's what everybody wants to do.
One question, does the inbuilt code, like the packages that might be shipping with the nodes, the base model, does it cover all the goodness of your existing web servers? ASP.NET, right?
No, so it's not like ASP.NET at all.
Okay.
It's only think of it as like really low level stuff. It'll give you an HTTP module, it'll give you a file module, it'll give you a crypto, really low level stuff. It doesn't do any. It doesn't say that I'm going to give you like framework or how to do routing.
So maybe the stuff like Ruby authentication.
No, it's basically like Node.
So not even authentication.
Microsoft analogy, you'll get IIS.
Huh.
You'll get IIS. You'll have to put the ASP.NET
on it. So you're basically getting just IIS. And even not even like IIS which runs.
But then IIS still have like, you know, SSL configuration.
Huh, but at least IIS runs. Node doesn't even run. You have to write code to make
it. Dedicated web, so I always put Node.js behind Nginx and offload a lot of things. Also, because it's better off that there will be some security stuff and all, which instead of us handling it.
So it's very, very bare bones.
I would trust someone like someone who's developing Node.js to do it much better off.
Huh. So, like you said, things like SSL, things like SSL, Nginx does well. Like IIS might do well. So you can offload all that to Nginx.
Like but the static serving, IIS does, Nginx does
well. No, we are just doing proxy here. Oh. So also like there was this instance a few months back where we were using a version of Node.js which was actually had a certain flaw, and they recommended either upgrade it immediately. Or use it behind Nginx, because Nginx, and there was some, when you are sending multiple requests bunched together in HTTP, Node.js had a vulnerability, which if Nginx is at the head of it, it would handle and correct it that nobody could exploit that. So sometimes it's just that you as an individual or as a small team who has a limited knowledge, you won't be able to handle all kind of security cases. So I would, as a sysadmin, I really prefer to put a dedicated engine server like Nginx or Apache ahead of it and let it proxy on the request.
So, but then this thing is only proxy request, it's not serving anything.
It can serve.
It can serve.
For sure, without a problem. But it really depends on, like, we are doing API, so we don't need to serve. Our static assets and all are on, we have an AngularJS for that, so that's a different thing. So, if you are serving it, definitely it can do that. Nginx can. We configure such that it Nginx serves the static assets and Node.js provides you the rest of the stuff.
That's how you usually go. But the present consensus is about static should be on CDN.
Yeah.
Okay. And Baki is up Node.js. Nginx will be serving as a proxy to, you know,
load balancing authentication.
पहला जो चीज होगी तू कौन है क्या है क्या कर रहा है इधर वो पहला रेंजिस करेगा फिर बाद में ओके चलो अभी सब करेगा
सो राजेश वन आई विल टेल यू द अदर थिंग सो इन द ASP.NET वर्ल्ड वी सॉर्ट ऑफ राइट एवरीथिंग एज वन बिग ऐप देयर इज नो सॉर्ट ऑफ स्मॉलर एप्स डूइंग स्टफ एंड ब्रिंगिंग इट टुगेदर एंड पुटिंग इन समथिंग सो ऑल इफ यू वर टू राइट अ MVC ऐप द MVC ऐप वुड हैव एवरीथिंग इट्स लाइक अ कंप्लीट Shabam, right? And then you put that one huge thing onto the server. The server serves it. But in the Node world, what we have sort of, or what we are doing, is that we have, instead of having like one big server, one big app, we have multiple small apps. So you have one app that does just the work. So our company, we do a lot of VoIP based stuff. So, in a small thing to put it, if you get a call saying that, sir, loan chahiye, it's probably some software. some software that a company like ours made. We don't make that. Sorry. But we do stuff like that, where we have like a component that dials out numbers. We have a component that sends messages to the client. We have a component that only handles queuing of messages. So you can have desperate different systems, right? One small system. Say humans have this ability to do things well when it's really small. We are really bad with sort of scope. Some people are really good at it. I have friends who can have massive scopes in their head and puke it. I, on the other hand, can only see this much. So the smaller your stuff is, that's why we write functions, right? We write smaller and smaller functions. Smaller and smaller modules so that you make better sense out of it. So in the Node world, instead of writing like this one huge big component, you write small instance servers that do specific things. So you would have like a server that is an API server. You would have like a messaging server. You would have something that does the dialing. Whatever. I mean, in your case, it would be down to you to sort of split. You could also have like one big server. There's no thing saying that don't have, but You could then scale better if you have smaller stuff, right? Cool. So I was talking about NPM, right? So the way you bring in modules is you can say, so let's say I wanted to use some package from NPM. Just have to find out where it is. So maybe I wanted to use this. This is a really popular package. You guys heard of underscore?
Yes.
You heard of underscore? So this is like, it's built on underscore, provides better stuff over underscore. So a lot of people have started using Lodash instead of underscore. So it's a play on underscore. It's Lodash. Get that play. Right. So it's basically a utility thing. You have array iterators, collection iterators, all that stuff. Right. And let's say I wanted to use this. Easiest way to do that is, okay. So let's say I wanted to use this in my app, right? So if you have npm installed, you just say npm install. And it goes out to the internet and gets it really fast. Okay, cool. So it just installed an external module for me. What it basically does is it just goes over the internet, just gets a couple of files down. Right. Strange. Where did I install it?
Dot. So, up and
direct. Why did I install it there? There is some trouble here, but basically what it should have done is it should have added a node underscore modules here, then added the file inside that. It's weird. Okay. So maybe that weirdness is because there is like a sort of hierarchy that node follows when it wants to either get something or put something. Right? So the general hierarchy is you have like a system level folder, node modules folder, you have a user level node modules folder, project level, and even like inside the project you can have multiple node modules. So because it found a node modules in the upper folder, we just thought that maybe it had to put it there. Because what happens is you could be inside jumpstart node and inside lib. Right? And if you say install npm install something, it would then put a node modules inside lib, which is not what you want. You wanted to put it in like the project folder. So it maybe does a, so I've never seen it before, I'm just, can you confirm that?
Sorry, what?
So basically what happened was that I did a npm install.
Okay.
There was no node modules in the current folder, but there was a node modules for some reason in my parent folder.
Okay.
Which is not part of the project. And I just installed it there.
And what do you want me to confirm?
That it checks for these.
Yeah, mileage. You did a global install. You did a global install before?
No, this is not a global.
It wasn't.
Should be traversing through your path, and the first node module, if it found the node module in the folder above,
First thing you look at your node modules. If not, you will go to your local and see the dot node modules out there. If you did a mine load as -g before, to the millions. Okay.
So here it was neither not the one in the home, neither the global one. This was the one above the parent directory of your code.
Yeah, you can look at the parent directory.
Yeah, that's what. If you look at it,
then it reaches the root. It is nothing. Okay, abhidara.
So it maybe traverses back the whole way. Okay. Okay, cool. So now it's done that. So it's got Lodash installed in a way. But if you go inside Lodash, all it has is this JS file. It's Lodash.js. Which will be just another module. See, be there somewhere. There'll be a module.exports somewhere inside there. It's a huge file. So it's exactly like the modules we wrote, but it's somebody else who's written it, and you're using that. So it might be like really complex. But one good thing, and it's because it's JavaScript, you have all the source code. It's open source. It's like a really awesome practice to just whatever library you are working with, if it's an external library, if you get the time, have a go through what they've done. Like, you learn tons of stuff. Like, I learned that you can use modules when I looked at some modules. Before that, I didn't, because nobody sort of tells you that you can write modules. Right? So it's like an insanely good thing in the JavaScript world. All the stuff is open source. Most of it is open source. You have like source code to see how everything works. So now that we have Lodash installed, I can then start using it here. It'll be like I was using my own module. So you say var whatever variable you want to give it equals to require Lodash. There's another thing that you can do is that when you do deploy this, you have to, like, if you want to tell people that, okay, I've written this awesome piece of server, you guys can use it. But how do they know that what external modules are you using? Because you just did npm install directly, right? So there's no way for them to like go through your code and figure out what you're using, what you're not using, what needs to be installed by me. So they have this sort of config file where you can list your dependencies. Tell people that, okay, this module requires these modules, and hence install them beforehand and then run stuff. Right? So you can do that easily with a package.json file. It's like a big, well, it's a JSON file, it has some structure to it. Easiest way to make one is just say npm init, right? So it'll ask you a couple of questions, you answer them, and it makes a package file for you. Say name, say yeah, version 1, the entry point is where your program will start from. So I did node index.js. Is this a way for people to use npm to start your thing? Rather than saying node, they can say npm start and it will just start. They don't have to know which file to use. Test commands, I don't have any tests, so obviously I can't put that. So it's already picked up, it knows that it's a Git repo. So it's picked up the, you can give it keywords. So usually keywords is for publishing modules. So if you have a module and you want to publish it, you want people to search for it. So you can give some relevant keywords, and after you publish it, when people search for those relevant keywords, they'll get your module. Don't want that. And this is a, you can specify a license, ID, and then it shows you what it'll look like. So it's a simplistic JSON. It just has key value pairs, name, what we gave it, version description. Main is the entry point, which is index.js. Another cool thing it did was we had already installed Lodash. Right? So it's gone through my node modules, figured out that I'm already using these modules. It's put them here. Right? And then you have these two dependencies. So you have dependencies and you have dev dependencies. So dev dependencies is usually things that you don't want. It's things that your app really doesn't need to work, but things like if you have like a memory profile or you have some debugger which you want to load, which is only in development. You don't want it there, so you can add that as a development dependency.
By the way, I want to specify on the dependencies. You can have a tilde ahead of that, which will actually signify that allow any minor version. So it won't stick to 2.4.1. If the latest version is 2.4.2, it will actually get, even if you say 2.4.1.
Like, so that's like a standard semantic versioning.
Is 2.4.1 or higher?
Yeah.
That's what it means.
Yeah, so I have a trouble with that idea. Because I've spoken with these guys at Hasgeek. They always prefer to use that. They don't pin to exact version. They do. They allow minor version upgrade and they test and it works well for them. We had trouble with that. We had some issues with a couple of libraries where the minor version also had some changes which weren't compatible and we ran into issues.
So
that means it didn't go TDD. Yeah.
See, I don't have tests here. It's a bad thing. It's my fault. But yeah, so basically what you're saying is that when we were developing, we had used a ton of external dependencies, right? And all the dependencies are loaded when you do an end. So once you've done this, what you can essentially then do is you don't need to publish your node modules folder because the node modules folder might be very machine dependent. When it was sort of installing one of your modules, it would have probably done like a make install, would have made a binary somewhere. So you can write in C++ as well.
Yeah, actually in Windows it happens in C++ to call
that. Yeah. So if you were to put node modules in and publish your full app, you can't just take stuff from my Linux machine and then have it run on like Windows because obviously the binaries are on. So the external modules, always it's preferred that you do a install on your machine. Only the code that is pertinent to my app, you need to get.
So even that's the reason when you must have done get, he's not checked in his node modules. He never does that. So you only do this and you run it on, you download the source code, do the MP install and you want.
So whenever I give this out to somebody, all they have to do is download my code. Before running my code, do an npm install. You'll go through this file, find whatever dependencies are, and it'll install them. Another thing is that Lodash itself will have other modules that it's dependent on. So you don't have to take care of that because they have a package.json as well. And they will internally run through that and it'll build that whole tree and give it to you. See?
And does the dependency detection tend to fail sometimes, or isn't it work pretty well?
No, dependency, suppose some of my internet connection is 40, I call and it breaks, so it fails, and it gives you
I mean the resolution, the dependency resolution itself, so...
No, that is perfect, that is like a solid, that's rock solid. The only problem is like this dependency, I see it. It gives you a window at npm, it gives you what is calling, and calling, and the internet can go boom. Error. Not okay. The last time the error not okay, and it will be there. So you have to do again. So that's
I think certain, like if you try to use automatic dependency detection in Python, which there isn't a standard way of doing in the first place,
okay.
You will run into bugs sometimes.
No, this one is pretty solid. And there's another way to store.
You can't point anything at your project and get a list of dependencies.
I use pip. You virtually and pip.
That's fine to download stuff that's already been published, but what if you want to publish your own? So, isme Lodash got detected as a dependency.
Right.
So that was only standard way in Python to actually detect a dependency of on your in your own code.
So
I'm not Python.
So it will detect only stuff that was there in your modules folder. If it is not there, you put it somewhere else and you are requiring it from somewhere else, you can't find it.
Yeah.
And what about...
so it also...
even if you have it in your global node modules, it is detecting?
No. So it's not... So I have like a couple of stuff installed it and pick up that. It won't go to your global node. So the idea is that you won't put globe, like stuff that is dependent on your in the globe.
The thumb rule is that just standard A, everybody is going to use all my other apps. I put it binary, npm install manager as globe. But something that only my app requires, because that particular one is the npm install.
So globally you would install things like, something like a generator. So you have things that generate code. You have things that do, there's a thing called grunt.
Build tools.
Yeah, build tools.
All apps will use the same build tool. Right?
But your app doesn't need it. Your app doesn't need a build tool to run. Cool. So, so yeah, this sort of ends my basics of Node. Unfortunately, I never got to the other parts. I had three more parts of this.
What are they?
So that basic Express and stuff. Basic WebSockets and all that stuff. So anyway, this was more for you guys to understand how to use Node. Not really how to get started with it, but at least you know now that you can do, you can probably not install Node, but at least how the smallest stuff works in Node. How to make your own modules, how to require other modules. So now it's all up to you. Like, you have a platform to stand on, and you can just, for example, I was going to show you Express, right? Because my next slide was that. By this time, I had thought that everybody would be kind of blank, not know what to do. Right? So it goes on to some practical stuff, which is Express.js. You guys can look it up. It's not really that difficult. It's really well documented. A lot of people use it. Express is just a way to write MVC-type apps fast. So at the end of the time, you can write like...
It's an MVC framework.
Yeah.
On a node server.
Yeah. So basically, you can remember how I wrote the whole routes, and I wrote how routes are I'm parsing routes and all that stuff. Inside an Express, all you can do is you can require Express. So you can see that Express is not a function; it's actually a class. So you can get an instance of the class, so you get an app, and then you can sort of declaratively put your routes. So that basically reads correctly as app.get root. Whenever somebody hits the root of your website or web app with a get request, just send a hi. That's it. That's all it does. So you can then extend it. You can go beyond. Express as a generator, so you don't have to start doing everything on your own. Generators are basically code generators. It'll give you a template. You can run command line You can just say express dash some options and your app name, and it will generate a ton of stuff for you. And then you can just keep extending it. Something like templates in MVC. MVC has these templates you can use, right? You say new project, select a template that you want, and it will give you some pre-built stuff. And
for me? No, I mean, what background are you coming in? Microsoft?
Java? Yeah, I have just a boiler kit to build over.
Yeah, because if you come from Microsoft, you have this. You create a new project through
even like, gives you the template
like
files.
JavaScript or Java, sorry, J2E or JTE. If you see most of the IDEs, which I want a new project, we create you all that stuff. Yeah. But just to put it that, see, now even these guys are actually moving from Express to something like Spark. QA, okay, because apparently the way that you know framework is, they couldn't like build on top of Express because they have bring down the architecture, there would be no backward compatibility. So they are now going on a new project, Koa.
Yeah.
And the, which I'm using right now is actually known as API. This is by Eric Hammer. He works with Walmart Labs, and this was used for the Black Friday. Now if any engine can take up Walmart's Black Friday sales peak scale, you know it's a shit, it's a bomb. Okay.
So there are more, like really more interesting stuff that you can do with Node. But one big pitfall again is what he said, that we have this experience as well, that since most of the stuff is open source and most of the stuff is being maintained by like one or two guys, right? So you have to really sort of get in there. We were using API library. What was it called? I don't remember what it was called. Before Restify. Before Restify, we were using something. I forgot the name. So anyway, whoever was maintaining that, it was really good. I'm not saying he wrote bad code or anything. It was a really good library. Was being used by everybody. For example, let's say it's Express. Everybody is using it. It's a good library. It's easy to read. There's good documentation. But one fine day, the fellow who's maintaining it decides that, I'm done. I'm not doing this anymore. Right? So you're kind of stuck with that whole thing that, okay, my app now uses this. I know that I can't go ahead. So one of the things you really have to do is sort of be in touch with the stuff that you're using. Like if you're using Express, try and look around what people are doing, what Express is doing. Get more ideas of what is happening there. So that if we don't get involved, then there's that thing where the person who is involved might just stop being involved, and then you're stuck in the loop because you were just consuming what they were saying. So big companies like Microsoft won't do that because tons of money they're getting for it. But obviously Express is not being maintained by anybody, so might go away.
Is your Holloway?
Yeah, he actually went away. So
he went to home.
Yeah. So that's one thing that you have to take care of. Like look at stuff that is being actively developed. A lot of people are actively involved in it. Maybe you want to get involved in it as well. And it's not that hard. Like Lodash. Lodash is still big. But maybe it's like a logger. Somebody might have written a logger that you're using extensively in your app. Loggers are like really small. Maybe like one file.
No, but you can say address code. Yeah. Just use address code, you use by everybody, even on the front end is the backbone, require underscore.
Yeah. Cool.
So okay, well, actually the reason why Node like is on the scene, like big plus, because it's concurrent with something else that's happening on the world. It's cloud computing. Okay? Now you gotta understand, if you've seen this, is how easy it is to just create a server and do it. You gotta understand also if you have scalability and you're getting weak. I just need to spawn another instance or whatever and run a very node on it, which takes minimum bare to set up and start. Yeah. And you all. So the scalability.
Yeah, so it's, as he said, it's really easy to scale. So one of the things that they did was the low level stuff is done really well. So they have this thing called cluster. Right. What you can do is you can write your node app, right? And right now, it can handle, let's say, X amount of stuff, right? On one core. You have like a quad core machine. It's only using one core because it's single threaded. you can use the cluster to easily, like without much resistance, scale to 4 cores, and you have 4x capacity, right? Throw an Nginx there, you can now scale to as many machines as you need, with as many cores as you need. So there's no limit to what you can do. But it also comes with the whole headache of how you do, that's the whole scalability thing. Like if your app has state, then obviously you can't scale, which is what we are facing right now. If one instance of the app is keeping some state, then you can't obviously cluster because state can't be shared between two processes.
Yeah, but you put a load balancer before, make sure only one memory is
getting. Yeah. So you have to like.
Right now, the state is being mentioned.
It's in memory, it's node's memory. So
we need to get it out before we can.
So that's a scalability issue. Yeah. It's, we never probably read about proper scalability. That's with all.
Probably need to get the state into a database.
Yeah.
See, usually what happens is, this is a user stack. You'll have Varnish engines, then you'll have a node, then have a memcache. Like if you do other kind of media on that, Redis, Redis ka bahut bada friend. So you'll have a Redis, then you'll have whatever, as the database body good.
Okay, cool. So I sort of took up all my time, right? So you guys can still look at these presentations. What I'll do is I'll add where I took these presentations from. So maybe you'll get better context. I just took like 3 or 4 different ones and combined them together into something that I could show you guys. Right? So it's online. You can always look it up. Probably try doing some of the exercises mentioned in there. If you have any trouble, you can always ping me on Twitter or just send out an email. I'm always there to help. And
thank you.